Let's start with, if you have any questions about this session, and then after we discuss the questions about this session, then we'll move to other questions from yesterday's sessions also. Okay. So you had a question? Yeah.
What is the opposite of intelligence?
Okay. That's a good question. So where does intelligence lie in this hierarchy? See, every frame of analysis includes some things and leaves something out. Because see, every categorization, analysis is basically categorization, and this falls in. Like if you have India, Pakistan, on the geographical map, this is India, this is Pakistan. But if you actually go at the border, it's not that everywhere there is a wall separating. You say, oh, this part is India, this part is Pakistan. Sometimes there might be a dispute. So if you say this river, the other side of the river is Pakistan, this side of the river is India. Okay, but then how much of the river water is Indian, how much of it is Pakistan? And is it that, so there can always be, any system of classification is a simplification. In fact, there's a philosopher of science, Karl Popper, who said that science is systematic oversimplification of reality. Systematic oversimplification of reality. That means when we look at science also, when science looks at the world, you can look at hundreds and hundreds of parameters. But science does controlled experiments. That means remove all parameters except the parameter that we are studying and then try to understand how it behaves. But reality is not that simple. So that's why you see that hard sciences like physics, chemistry, they are much more predictable than what is called a soft sciences like psychology or economics, if at all you want to call them sciences. They are not that easily predictable. So the point I'm making is that this frame is basically to understand that there are multiple levels of innateness within us. So now the mind can be used generically to refer to the subtle body. And you differentiate between the mind and intelligence basically by saying that the propensity, there is a voice within us which prompts, which is impulsive. Come on, just do it. There is a voice within us which says, look before you leap. So we could say the short-term voice is the voice of the mind. The long-term voice is the voice of the intelligence. But it's not that simple. Because Krishna also says in the Bhagavad-Gita in 340 and 41 that lust or self-destructive desire is situated in the intelligence also. Indriyani mano buddhir asyadhishthana muchyate etair vimohayatesha jnanamavritya dehinam indriyani mana buddhi. All three of them, the self-destructive desire is situated within us. So you could say that what I call generically as the mind, you could divide it into three levels: the mind, the intelligence, and the ego. So to extend a software metaphor, you could say that the mind is like the, if you have a computer or you have a phone, then there are user installed programs, there are pre-installed programs, and then there is a basic operating system. So the ego, you could say, like the operating system, basic operating system. Then so that's it's much more innate to the interface. Then you could say the intelligence is like the pre-installed programs, and the mind is where our impressions go in, the actions that we do, the impressions. So it's more like user installed programs. So you could categorize the software like that. But sometimes it is that, say, recently in the iPhones, they had in their OS itself update, there was an innate bug. And then they had to withdraw some of the phones. Samsung had, say, I was in Australia and some Samsung phones were just exploding. So there's the, at the immigration, normally they check your security. So they said, if you have the Samsung phone, you cannot enter into the plane, or at least you have to abandon this phone before you can enter into the plane. Because anywhere a phone explodes is dangerous, but if you explode in the plane, it's much more dangerous. So sometimes there might be something which is faulty within the pre-installed software itself, or it could be in the OS also. So rather, so we could classify it like this. So the, why I'm making this seemingly complicated analysis is that we can't just say the mind is bad and the intelligence is good, because sometimes the intelligence can also be bad. Just like I said, some people are wicked, then they use their intelligence to plan how to do wrongdoing in a way that nobody catches them, and they can hurt the other person. So the intelligence, so sometimes, but so the intelligence can also be used to do bad. So you could say that good and bad is stored at all levels. The ego itself is always not always a bad thing. Like Krishna tells Arjuna in 2.13 that you are not the body or the soul. Dehinosmini tha dehe kaumaram yamunim jara. But then 2.14, immediately the next verse, he says, Matra sparshastu konteya shitoshnasuka dukkhataha agamapayino nityastam sthitikshasva bharata. So he uses two names to refer to Krishna, Bharata and Konteya. And both names are related to the body, isn't it? Kunti, the soul is not the son of Kunti, it's the body that is the son of Kunti, isn't it? So similarly, Bharata is a descendant of the Bharata dynasty. But so sometimes our identifying with a particular role, that can also inspire us to do something good. Say, if you know, okay, I'm from this glorious family, I will not behave in a cowardly way. I will not behave in such a cheap way. I will not get corrupted. I am from an illustrious family. So sometimes our ego might also inspire us to do good. Sometimes our ego may make us arrogant and dismiss others and crush others. So you could say that good and bad is something which is presented in all the three levels of the programming. But generally, because if you look inside, you know, there is no, the inner voices don't come with a label. This is the mind speaking, don't listen to me. This is the intelligence speaking, listen to me. Whenever the voice starts coming, it starts pushing us. So what we, that's why I simplified this over here. Basically said that the mind has different kind of impressions. So it's very difficult for us to know when it is the mind speaking and when the intelligence speaking. So rather than worrying about the source, we can focus on the effect. That means that if there is this voice prompting me from within, do something. If I act on it, what will happen? Is this inspiring me to do something good or inspiring me to do something bad? So we look at the effect or the consequence and then we choose. Does that answer your question? Any other questions? Yes, please, behind. So educated people often don't acknowledge their suffering even when they are, and even when they do some indulgences, they seem to justify those indulgences rather than accept that they are wrong. Whereas poor people are more likely to acknowledge their suffering. So is there something wrong with the education system? We all have to resist the temptation to oversimplify reality. That means that life is immensely complex, and it is not easy to say this is the problem and if you just fix this, things will be solved. It's very easy to scapegoat or demonize things. Now we could say modern education is bad, or it makes people into less receptive for spiritual wisdom. But it's not that simple. It is largely people who are reasonably educated, they can understand philosophy if they want to. But people who are not very well educated, they can't even understand philosophy. And that's how they are also very much more likely to be misled. If they get a good spiritual guidance, they can turn toward God easily. But if they get some godmen, they can be exploited also. So I don't think we can say that there's something bad with respect to the educational system itself. Definitely the educational system, to some extent, it helps us to think analytically and critically. And then you cannot have that capacity to think critically directed selectively. Then if they want to think critically, they are going to think about religion also critically. But what happens is that often, because the overall culture is materialistic, so then they don't think about materialism that critically. They can. Actually, some of the strongest critiques, like the researchers or studies pointing out the problems with alcoholism or drugs, they are also written by materialistic people. There is, in the New York Times, there's a big article about how pornography is a big problem. And so the whole point of the article is that we are not condemning porn on religious grounds. Because what happened is that anything you associate with religion, people start saying, oh, you're just imposing your religious morals on us. But even from a simply human perspective, what they found is that, so these people very strongly assert that we are concerned about this based on its human consequence, not on its religious consequence. So they found that because of too much indulgence in that, that kind of thing, then people just, I don't want to use too blunt language. Basically what happens is that people, they see all these kind of images, and in real life they don't get stimulated at all. And then because of that, real relationships, they don't happen. People, marriages break down, and people live in isolation and loneliness. So psychological, social, now these are surveys done by people who have no religious backgrounds. So I wouldn't say that the educational system itself is bad. What happens is, it's the overall culture which is materialistic. And see, the culture in which we live, unless somebody outside the culture prods us, it's very difficult to be critical of that. The culture is like a given for us. So somebody who's always eaten meat, for them to think that there's anything wrong in eating meat, don't even think about it. It's only when somebody I was at a school, so there was this one small girl at a school, she says, I'm a vegetarian, I'm a vegan, she said. I'm a vegetarian, she said. And then there's another girl, she says, I'm also a vegetable. She didn't even understand, I'm also not a vegetarian, I'm a vegetable. She didn't even understand, but okay, this girl was like very smart and intelligent, maybe like an 8-9 year old girl, and this other girl was 6 year old girl. So she said, I'm a vegetarian. She says, I'm also a vegetable. So she didn't even know the vegetarian word, but what happened? She's doing this, I also want to do it. So if something is going on in our mainstream culture, it's very difficult to be self-critical about that. So the overall culture is materialistic. And that's why materialism, we don't question that. So in general, educated people, if they're grown through a particular system, they will not, you can use your intelligence to justify anything. But is the educational system bad? More than the educational system, I would say it is the culture associated with the educational system that is problematic. The culture is that say, I suppose it has come in India also, that, but especially in the Western countries, it's a culture of sexuality that is always associated, sexuality and drugs. The drugs are available anywhere where there are colleges and students. So I feel the culture is more of a problem. The content of the education, yes, it would be good if it could be spiritual, but it's difficult in today's multicultural world. How do you implement that? How do you find out spiritual values which don't come off as imposing one religion on others? So there was this, maybe 4 or 5 years ago, there was this proposal that Bhagavad Gita should be made India's national book. So I was asked about this by some newspaper. I said that, you know, rather than imposing Bhagavad Gita as a national book, we should present it, Bhagavad Gita, as a book of wisdom rather than a book of religion. And then, because it is a book of wisdom that has emerged in India, so we should study it, not necessarily as a religious book. If we have that attitude and try to derive the wisdom, this is what our own national heritage is there. So we need to present things appropriately. Then things can move forward. So the education system definitely has its deficiencies, no doubt about it. But it's that one of the characteristics of intelligence, the Bhagavatam describes, is doubt. Atha samshayo viparyasa. The capacity to doubt is a characteristic of the intelligence. Now you go see some advertisements, and some people who are uncritical, they might just believe, oh, if I buy this, I'll get this. If I just apply this cream, I'll become like this. You know, but somebody is a little critical intelligence. Is this promise really true? So the capacity to doubt is a sign of intelligence. And as far as suffering is concerned, yes, if you see the Scandinavian countries in Europe, they rank as among the highest in world happiness surveys. But they are also countries which are associated with the highest sales of antidepressants. Then are you really happy if you need to take depression, antidepressant pills? You say, obviously not, you're so depressed. But they rate themselves as happy. Now, on what reference point do they rate themselves as happy? It's based on the kind of culture that you have. We acquire certain conceptions of happiness. So for example, see, in the Western world now, being vegan, which is just a variant of being vegetarian, being vegan is considered very cool. And thousands of people are becoming vegans now. So all the conventional Western foods, hot dogs and hamburgers, now all of them have vegan alternatives. So to be vegan is cool, but in India, it is to be non-vegetarian is a cool now. All these old religious taboos, give it up and eat meat, then you are cool. So there are certain cultural trends which are there, and when people have acquired certain cultural conceptions, oh, if I have a house, if I have a car, if I have this, then I am happy, then my life is good. Now whether it is actually good or not, that is open to question. So what happens if poor people are ready to acknowledge that they are suffering and wealthy people are not ready to acknowledge their suffering? That's largely because they have equated happiness and suffering with certain symbols, certain trappings. Oh, if I don't have a good house to live in, if I don't have water supply, if I don't have electricity, I am suffering, because I see so many others who have that. So rather than simply saying that, oh, wealthy people don't acknowledge their suffering, we have to help them re-examining their conceptions of happiness. To the extent we help them re-examine their conceptions, then they will themselves start admitting, you know, say, I'm happy in life. Oh, but you just scrape a little below the surface, they say, actually, you know, I see a psychologist every week. Oh, you know, my wife left me. My child is a drug addict. Oh, you know, so if all these things are wrong in your life, can you really say you're happy? Yeah, there's a lot of problems in my life also. So people have certain definitions of happiness, and they often don't examine those definitions. So rather than saying that education is itself problematic, it is problematic, but rather it's not the education, it's the culture which is of which the education is a part. So if we can help people recognize that there's something beyond matter, then actually the modern education can help people to see, can help the intelligence to be developed sufficiently so that one can philosophically understand spirituality. Otherwise, it's more of a sentimental practice of spirituality, not a philosophical practice of spirituality. Does that answer your question? Thank you. Yes, we'll come back to you. Yeah? What is?
What is unlimited? So there must be a limited task for a person. But Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says that Hare Nama Kev Nama. So how can this be
handled? Okay. If God is unlimited, should there be unlimited paths to approach Him? I didn't say exactly that. I said that if God is unlimited, why should the paths to Him be limited? See, it's not that just because something should not be limited doesn't mean it has to be unlimited. They're two different things. It is, all that I said is that even limited is also one over there. So why should there be only one path to God? Now, when we say Hare Nama Eva Kevalam, what is it? It's in scripture, there are certain statements which are given for emphasis. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he said the holy name is the way. You could say it's the only way. But did Chaitanya Mahaprabhu only chant the holy names? Did he not study Shastra? Did he not visit temples? Did he not go to holy places? Why did he do all those things? If the holy name is the only thing, he could just have chanted the holy names. You could say that he went to the temple and chanted the holy names. He went to the holy place and chanted the holy names. He discussed philosophy and inspired others to chant the holy names. But there are different ways to approach transcendence. And we could say in Kali Yuga, the holy name is the most potent way. But you cannot reduce bhakti to any one thing. There are ninefold activities of bhakti. So there are different ways in which bhakti can be practiced. And even if you want to say the holy name is the only way, even if, so what it means essentially is that in this particular age, the holy name is the most potent way to connect with Krishna. But that doesn't necessarily mean that nobody can connect with Krishna except through the holy name. It is a recommended process. But what do you mean by the holy name also? Prabhupada said even if you chant the name, any name of God, if you chant the name of Christ, that's also a name of God. Allah is also a name of God. So it might seem exclusivist, but if you look at the overall import, the principle is that this is a very potent way, so take this way. Like yesterday I said that sometimes the doctor suggests forget all of the medication and take this. So this kind of statements are there for focus. They are not for rejecting other paths, but they are meant to create a focus on this particular path. It's like in our temples, our movement, we focus on the chanting, but we also have temples with deity worship, and a good amount of energy is spent on deity worship because the deities can help us develop a personal relationship with God, and then we can chant His names better. So we can't reduce bhakti to one thing, but there are certain things which are especially potent and especially important. So see this statement as a statement for creating focus and emphasis, not as rejection. Okay. If some people are practicing different religions, will they reach God? It depends on their consciousness. We can't say that, all Hindus or all Christians or all Muslims are at one level. It's everybody is an individual and everybody is individually developing their consciousness. And if they develop love for God, they will attain God. If they don't develop love for God, then to the extent they have gone on that journey, God will help them move forward. And by that, they will get in the future life a place where they can continue their journey. That way, we can't say necessarily that just everybody who is affiliated with the Krishna consciousness movement is automatically going back to Godhead. We also have to develop love for God. So it's like you have to get to the top of the mountain. So is it that now we as practitioners of Krishna consciousness will share what are the advantages of going by this path? And like I talked about test criteria yesterday. So there are certain advantages to this path that can make this climb easier. But is it that other people on the other paths can't climb up? They can. And it's not that everybody on that path is at the same destination, at the same level. Everybody is at a different level. So it depends on individual consciousness. A person practices their particular religion to evolve and develop love for God, then they will attain God. It depends more on our disposition than our affiliation. Okay? If they don't know that God is Krishna, yes, it depends on where they go. See, if somebody has accepted Jesus as their guide, then Jesus will guide them along. That maybe in the transition after this life, while they are going to the spiritual world, they might come to know Krishna as God and then they will devote to Him. But God can have different manifestations. Advaitam Achyutam Anadim Ananta Rupam. So Ananta Rupam, unlimited forms. So now, actually the Christian tradition does not have much specific description of God's form. So it's there's very little in that tradition which will be contradictory to the conception of Krishna as God. That form, in that particular form, is not described there specifically. But there's nothing there are universal attributes of God and there are specific attributes of God. So universal attributes could be, say, omnipotence, omniscience, omnipresence. These are universal attributes. And there are specific attributes. Say, we say that God, he has a peacock feather, he has a bluish-black complexion. So now the specific attributes of God can help us develop a specific relation, can help us develop a personal relationship with the Lord in that particular manifestation. But as far as devotion is concerned, that can be developed even by knowing the universal attributes of God. So that devotion may not be that specific towards a particular form, but devotion is ultimately a disposition of the heart. So when exactly that may happen, somebody who follows Jesus, which part of the spiritual world they go to, which manifestation of God they worship, and whether they go immediately or they go to some intermediate destination, and there they get introduced to the Krishna conception of God, and then they move forward. It'll all vary. There are, across the world when I travel, I've met many people, many devotees. They said that when we came first to there's one girl, young girl, around 7-8 years old. She was in Poland and she was telling me that, her mother was telling me, and she was also telling me that, and, you know, she was just walking along the streets and she pulled her mother, I want to go here. She says, what is there? No, I want to go here. And then there was this, one of our leaders, Indradyumna Maharaj, does this festival of India. So they had this big program. Now you could say that it's a child, she may have heard that some like fun is over here, we want to go like a fair over there. But in that there are many multicultural activities for people. They put gopi dots, dress in a particular way or have some fun. But in that whole festival of India, she took her mother straight to the deities. And she went there and she was beholding them. What attracted her? Her mother didn't even know what it is, so beautiful. It was not just for her, it was not just beauty. How did she get attracted? Krishna says in the Bhagavad-Gita that Purvabhyasena tenaiva riyate yavashopisaha jigyasurapi yogasya shabda brahmati vartate. If there is purva abhyas, if there is past practice, then riyate yavashopisaha. It's almost helplessly somebody is attracted toward the Lord. So there are many examples of people being attracted like that. So how exactly the journey will go on beyond this life, we don't know that. But if somebody is turning toward God, then God will guide them onward. Okay? Yes?
The impressions of the actions and the past life memory, are they stored in the mind or in the intelligence?
Both places. Are the impressions stored in the mind or the intelligence?
It's the past life memory.
Oh yeah, of the past life. It's a... How do you understand the difference between mind and intelligence? Well, it's on YouTube, there are some videos of children in diapers playing a piano. And how do they do that? And they're musical maestros. Sometimes you have maths whiz kids. I was in Kannada, I was staying at a devotee's place. His son is like 8 years old and he is like a national Kannada under 10 champion. And he is just, you know, he's brilliant. So now you could say that, oh, his father is also a chess player, his father encouraged him. Yes, but he's at the age of 8, he's much better than his father also. So certain abilities also come to us from our previous lives. So now, where are those abilities coming from? The idea of prodigies. Prodigies means people who have, kids who have phenomenal talents. That's universal across cultures. There's a European philosopher, I think, Page. You know, he wrote a paper in a journal at the age of 12. And that paper was so good that journal's editor offered them that, you know, you can become the head of department of our philosophy department. And then his parents had to write back saying that, you know, he cannot become the HOD because he's 12 only, right? Can't even go out of house alone. So there are people who are brilliant. Where does that brilliance come from? It's from previous lives. So you could say that what we have learned, it can carry on from a previous life to the next life also. So generally, it doesn't. But the impressions depend on how deep they are. Generally, no child grows up saying, instead of crying, it doesn't say A, B, C, D, E, F, G. It grows, born is crying. So basically, there is a biological layer of covering which is there for everyone. But if there are impressions from the past of what we have learned, then the uncovering happens much faster. It's like when we are born, we could say at the visible level, we are all ignorant. It's not that children are born, they know language. But some children pick up language very fast. Some pick up very slowly. So like that, there is what we have learned in the past, that if it is deeply impressed within us, that can be carried on in the next life. So now this is with respect to intelligence, with respect to specific abilities. But you could also have intelligence. I sometimes differentiate between intelligence and intellect. Intellect is basically specific skills. Somebody has mathematical intelligence, somebody has musical intelligence, somebody has analytical, somebody has, say, linguistic intelligence. All these kind of intelligences are there. But beyond that, you could also say behavioral intelligence. Behavioral intelligence means, how does a person function in life? Are they responsible or short term? Are they ethical or unethical? That can also, generally when we use the word intelligence, it is in that sense. You know, when the impulses come, can you resist those impulses or not? So even with respect to that also, not all kids are similar. Some kids, they get angry and they just throw a tantrum. Some kids get angry, but they don't throw a tantrum. So it varies. So why does it vary? Because the impressions are different in different people. So every action that we do, good or bad, the impressions are stored on it. Now, how deep the impressions are, how accessible those impressions will be in the future lives, that will vary depending on a lot of situations. Mm-hmm. I have written a book on reincarnation where I talk about past life memories. Now, some kids have past life memories. All of us have had past life, but not all of us have past life memories. Because it depends on where the memories have been embedded, what kind of situations we come through in the next life. And especially whether a kid has past life memories or not depends on largely on the event of death. Means if somebody has a sudden abrupt death, then what happens is that the soul doesn't get the time to process the event of death. And then because the death of that event of death has not been processed, that's why the memories from the previous life are carried over to the next life. It's just like if you suddenly go from one country to another, say if you go from India to America, then for a few days you experience jet lag. Because the body is accustomed to the Indian time. So by you start from India when it's morning and it's maybe 20 hours you reach there. But by that time it's morning over there, where you are tired and you are sleeping. So it takes time for the body to get adjusted to the cycle over there. So like that, there could be a body lag. Soul has gone from one body to another body, but because the event of death was not processed, so those impressions still stay, and those impressions keep troubling. And usually those children are troubled till they have some kind of closure. There are kids who just suddenly, maybe 2 years old kids, mummy, mummy, where is my other mummy? What? I start saying, my mummy's name is this, and she stays here, and she does this, and I want to go and see her. And then, actually, it's even four layers of evidences over there. There are, in my book, it says, there are just recollections, then there are recognitions. The children go over there, they say, actually recognize, this is my mother, this is my sister, this is my this. This is the place, this is my house, this was my toy, like that. Then there are behaviors. Let's say, if somebody meets, there are stories of like a five-year-old boy meeting a woman from his previous life who he claims his wife. And he treats her like his wife. And if he has children from his previous life, they are older than him, but when he sees them, he ruffles his hair and treats them like his kids. Although they are physically smaller than him, physically bigger than him. There are behaviors. And then there are also birthmarks. Somebody was shot dead, maybe a bullet went into their head and came out. Then there are maybe some kind of swellings at the entry and exit point of the bullet. In the next life's body also. So basically, how the impressions will affect the previous life, how the impressions will affect the next life will vary depending on situation to situation. But as I said, the good and the bad side is there in the mind, intelligence, ego, all of them. So sometimes we might have certain kinds of intelligence from a previous life. Mm-hmm. There was one boy, Jagbir Singh, is born in UP, and he said at age of 2.5, he was born in a Jat family, and he said, I am a Brahmin, I cannot eat this food. And he refused to eat food in his own house. And till the age of 8, his father had to hire a local Brahmin to come and cook food and bring for him, because he wouldn't eat in his own house. Where did this come from? Now for the parents, it's embarrassing that their son doesn't eat food in their own house. Isn't it? But it happens. Now these are really exceptional cases, but the point is that the impressions from the previous lives come in the next lives. And how they manifest, that will vary from person to person. Of course. See, for all practical purposes, the whole covering, mind, intelligence and ego, is the same. There is no difference between them in structural terms. It's only in functional terms. Like, say, if I talk about the codes, I talk about user install programs or pre-install programs or OS. Now, from the coding perspective, it's all just code, isn't it? If you go at the digital level and you look at it, it's not that a user install program and a pre-install program, they're intrinsically what? They're just basically a series of numbers, a sequence of 01010101, which programs the computer device to behave in a functional way. So structurally, the codes are not different. It is functionally how they act, they are different. So a virus and an antivirus. A virus program and antivirus program, they're structurally the same. Both of them are basically codes, but functionally they're not just different, they're opposite. So similarly, the mind, intelligence and ego, they are structurally the same. It's functionally they are different. All of them are subtle reality. The Bhagavatam in the third canto, when it describes the characteristics of all of these, it describes them primarily in functional terms, not in structural terms. It's like earth and water, structurally they are different. Fire and air, structurally they are different. But in subtle world, structure, there's no structural difference, it's only primarily functional difference. Yeah.
Is there any other way to go about Godhead than pleasing the spirit?
Is there any way to go back to Godhead other than pleasing the spiritual master? Well, definitely displeasing the spiritual master is not the way to go back to Godhead. See, we have to understand the principle everywhere. The principle is that Sangat Sanjayate Kamaha. Desires develop in association. Kama is desire, Sangha is association. So our desires develop in the association that we are in. And the spiritual master is, ideally speaking, the person who has intense desire for Krishna. And by the association, when we please the spiritual master, what does it mean? The spiritual master has a desire to serve Krishna, and if we do something to serve Krishna, that pleases the spiritual master. So then, by that association and by that blessing, that the desire for Krishna is kindled within us. So if the desire for Krishna is kindled within us, that's what will take us back to Krishna. Ultimately, it is not that Krishna wants us to be here in this world. Krishna wants us to be back with him. But we often desire the world more than we desire Krishna. So our desire for Krishna has to become stronger than the desire for the world. And how will that happen? That will be associating with those who have that desire stronger than desire for Krishna stronger than desire for the world. And by that association, our desire gets transformed. So to the extent our desire gets transformed, to that extent we will attain Krishna. So the principle of pleasing the spiritual master is basically the principle of following the process that will transform our desire, that will nourish our spiritual desire. So we shouldn't think of it like it's not like a personal monopoly on God. It's not that this person has the sole rights to take you to God. It's not like that. Prabhupada also said the spiritual master is not just a person. The spiritual master is the principle. There is Guru and there is Guru Tattva. So anybody who is showing us to the path towards Krishna, anybody who has a desire for Krishna, anybody who is helping us to develop our desire for Krishna, that person represents the spiritual master. And if we please them and the desire for our spiritual master is strengthened within us, then we attain Krishna. What is the reason for you asking this question?
You said that there are many paths. There can be people by chanting.
Okay, ultimately we have to develop love for Krishna. And it is very, very difficult to develop love for Krishna simply by contemplation or meditation. It is largely our desires that develop by association. Our desires are not just linear, they are triangular. That means we see an object and we have a desire for that object. That's one way desires develop. But for many things, the desires develop by triangular. Just like say, if you hear this book is a bestseller, maybe I'll read it, maybe I'll not read it. But if you have a friend who is just constantly absorbed in reading that book, every moment they get, immediately open that book and read it. Hey, what is there in this book? I want to find out. Just seeing that book didn't create the desire, but seeing somebody reading that book created the desire. That is triangularity of desires, not just linearity of desires. So we definitely need personal association and personal guidance. That's what will take us. That will trigger, activate the principle of triangularity of desires and take us towards Krishna. So if we follow a particular tradition and a particular path, then we have to follow the specifics of that path. So now you could say specifically in Judaism or Christianity, they may not have the concept of a spiritual master per se. They may not have the concept of initiation. But then they do have a concept that there are certain people who are the pastors, the community leaders. And you take guidance from them and go forward. So it's like, if I'm going up the mountain by this path, then I have to follow the guidelines which are required for this path. If I'm following the mountain, climbing up the mountain by some other path, then I have to follow the guidelines for that path. So we need the association of those who have love for God. Only then we will get love for God. Now specific practices such as taking initiation, going through a fire sacrifice where Diksha is given, that is something which is, that can vary. That is, the important principle is we go up the mountain. And if I am going up the mountain by a path that is rocky, and then if I expect to use the shoes that are designed for a slippery path, that is a mismatch. So if you follow a particular path, then we need to follow the guidelines of that path, that will elevate us. Okay. Who has not asked till now? Yeah. Very genuine question, that 9 times we may resist the proposition, but 10 times we succumb. And how can we ensure that we don't succumb at all, and that if we resist it, does it become stronger in future? Okay, let's find this. See, we all have urges. And you could say that the urges have surges. So the urge, if you look at it, is not always the same. I want to eat, I want to sleep, I want to watch this movie, I want to, even alcoholics. Even, it's not that 24 hours they are constantly craving for alcohol with the same intensity. So sometimes when the surges come, it may be very difficult to resist. And so we don't have to define our spirituality solely by what happens when the surges come. What are we doing between the urges? The surge comes, it goes. Actually, you could put it this way, inside this. This is a broad wavering of our consciousness, but more specifically, you could say our consciousness is like this, the surge. It goes like this. So now, we often, when we fail over here, we start beating ourselves up. You know, I am worthless. I am incorrigible. I can never change. But even if we can't resist the urges, we can persist between the urges. What we are doing in between the urges is much more important, because that's where our consciousness is going to be most of the time. So even if somebody gets a particular urge once a day, but that urge may be for maybe 10 minutes, 15 minutes, half an hour, 1 hour, whatever. But remaining 23 hours, what are they doing? If the 23 hours they are engaging in purificatory activities, doing something constructive, then gradually what will happen is they will become stronger. So the just like in a war, the battle is not won simply based on how you perform in the war. Of course, you have to perform in the war. But the soldiers have to go to so much training before that. And Just like say the Cricket World Cup is going on now. The players have to perform in the World Cup matches if they are to win the World Cup. But how they perform in the World Cup tournament is not determined just based on, it's not that somebody who has never practiced cricket suddenly will get in the World Cup match and score a double century and be a match winner. It's very, very unlikely to happen. They have to do so. Their performance at that time in the cricket match is what is primarily visible. But that performance is shaped by the practice that they have been doing for a long, long, long time. So similarly, if you focus only on this, the urges, we are actually misunderstanding the nature of how our mind and our how we function basically. So first thing is, don't get obsessed too much over this. Look at the overall life and see whether we are living purposefully, positively, striving for purity in the rest of our life. If we are doing that, so when you say that 9 times out of 10 we are able to resist, that means, you know, you could have some minor urges in between, there we are able to resist, but then a big urge comes up, then it's very difficult to resist. So don't define the spirituality, our spirituality, simply by our capacity to resist urges. It's more how much we are connected with Krishna and how strongly we want to stay connected with Krishna. That is important. If we are committed to regularly practicing bhakti, we will get purified. Now, how long will it take for us to be able to resist those urges? That can vary. One thing which we could do is to try to find out some anchors for ourselves. Anchor means, when these urges come, they are like waves. If you are in an ocean and the waves are coming, I'll not be swept away by the wave. Oh, you fight, but how can you fight? The wave will sweep you away. But if at that time you hold on to some anchor, then also the wave will come, it will sweep you. But it is much easier, or rather, it is much more likely. It's never easy, and the wave is sweeping you away, to hold on to it is always tough. But it is relatively speaking much more likely that we won't get swept away if we are holding on to an anchor. I was in traveled to almost like 50 places in the last 4 or 5 months. I was in Phoenix, not in Phoenix. I was in New York, so there I was giving a talk, and there was a Sri Lankan over there. He told me that he was on the beach of Sri Lanka when in 2004 the tsunami came. And you know, he was there on the beach and suddenly saw this huge wave. See, the tsunami is in the ocean, it doesn't appear like a tsunami. It's only when it comes to the edge, then what happens is it collides with the land and it rises up. He saw this giant wave, he started running. Couldn't outrace it. So what happened, that tsunami came and struck him and it flung him, but fortunately it flung him and banged him against a tree. And he banged against the tree, but then it like a branch high up, and he held on to that branch, and then he held on, the water surged, and he could see it was land. Suddenly everything had become like an ocean around him. But he was holding on to it, and he held on to it, and after an hour or so, the water subsided, he was rescued. So if he had not hit accidentally also against that tree, and at that time the force was not that great, if it hit very hard, he could have been killed just by the blow, the force, but that was not very hard, so he managed to hold on to it. So that is what saved him. So it's an anchor. So we need something to hold on to when our desires, our urges, those the propositions start coming, it'll come like waves which will sweep us. So now each of us has to find out what can be an anchor for us. So for some people it might be just chant the holy names. So some people it may be that, you know, if you like to hear classes, study philosophy. Then if you have heard some very good talks, you have heard some good wisdom, keep those talks, keep those, at least those sections from those talks readily available for you. If you like some quotes, some verses, keep those verses readily, read them, recite them, and that way keep that accessibility. Then with that anchor, it will be more easily possible for us to resist it. Thank you. Yeah. What is the source of? What is the source of the emotions? You can have all three sources. The body, mind and the soul. All three can be there. See, that means that sometimes, like, you may feel uncomfortable right now because it's too hot. So now some people's body, it tends to sweat a lot. Some people, they can tolerate heat and they don't sweat so much. They don't feel so uncomfortable. So that discomfort which you're feeling, it can be actually because of some physical situation. But suppose you can consider that, say, if somebody is sitting in this class and they're already bored with the class, then even a little discomfort will appear very large. I'm uncomfortable. Because the focus is not on what they're hearing. So then, where will the focus go? Oh, I'm sweaty, I'm tired. So that is a physical sensation for that. There is a physical part to it, but the mind has magnified it much more. So sometimes some emotions might come from the body itself, body and the physical reality. Just like, say if you now, suppose after this program we have prasad. There's no suppose, prasad is there. But suppose there's some particular delicacy you like. As soon as you see that, a desire comes over there. But sometimes, even if there's no sight, you know, just get the desire. You know, it will be so nice to tell. Nice if I can get a gulab jamun. Nice if I can get a jalebi. So the desire might come from inside, with no particular stimulation from outside. Beyond that, the soul is also capable of pure spiritual emotions, which has got nothing to do with the body or the mind. So the soul is presently the source of consciousness. Now consciousness is the capacity to be aware and to experience everything, including desires. So you could say there is consciousness and there is the content of consciousness. Content of consciousness. So the content of consciousness is shaped by the physical situations and the mental impressions. But consciousness itself comes from the soul. And the pure consciousness of the soul has a pure attraction for the divine. So we could say that if in the purified stage, the attraction towards devotional things, that kind of desires come from the soul itself. So presently we could say most of our desires and emotions, they come from the body and the mind. That means they come either from the physical stimulation around us or they come from the mental impressions within us. Did I answer your question? Yeah.
Yesterday you mentioned about word visions. Can you elaborate about the vision? Like, in one of your previous five incarnations, you have mentioned that Buddhism is considered an offshoot of Hinduism. But the Buddhists, they interpreted it back to opposite that it was they had the concept of Dhamma. And they said that Hinduism, like the Brahmins, they came to the Buddhists, and from later on, all this salary is continuing something like this. What is their basis of saying? Buddhism
is actually coming before Hinduism, and how can we defend our scripture? And also, we say that Buddha is the incarnation of Vishnu. How can we defend that? Complicated question. So the question is that, if I understand rightly, that Buddhists claim that the concept of Dhamma was developed by them, and then Hindus took it afterwards as Dharma. We say that actually Buddhism is a Hindu offshoot of Hinduism, and that Buddha is the incarnation of Vishnu. So how do we understand this? See, in every religion there is a tendency to reinterpret reality in a way that is in harmony with that religion. So for example, in the Greco-Roman history, there were very well-known Greek philosophers, Plato, Socrates, and then Aristotle. So now, the Bible itself does not contain much philosophy. So if you consider the Middle East, that's where Jerusalem and all of these places, that's where the Christianity emerged. And then Paul and others took it to Europe, the Galatians and others. And there, now they had this devotional fervor, but then they didn't have philosophy, because the Bible itself is not, with all due respects to it, if you read the book, it's mostly the incidents from Jesus' life, that's the Gospels. And then most of the Bible is basically Paul's epistles, the letters which Paul and the other prophets wrote to giving some instructions to people at various places. There's not much philosophy in the Bible. So the Christians encountered the deep philosophical ruminations of the descendants of the Greek philosophers in the European area. Then what they did was, they integrated Greek philosophy with biblical theology. And to do this, often they portrayed Socrates and Plato and Aristotle as pre-Christ Christians. Pre-Christ Christians. Now, how is that possible? He says, no, the same God who sent Christ, he sent these people before so that they would speak this philosophy which Christ would use. Well, you could say like that, but what is the evidence for that? Now, there's no, Socrates did not talk anything about Christ directly. He's a philosophical person, much more. So this tendency is there, you know, in every religion. There is a version of the Ramayana which is called Jain Ramayana. Now, Jainism is itself a very, you could say, relatively speaking, a sattvic religion. Sattvic in the sense that Jains also live quite purely. But in terms of ideology, philosophy, there have been quite bitter conflicts between Jains and Buddhists, Jains and Vedic followers. So what the Jain Ramayana is, it's the basic story of the Ramayana is similar. That there's Ram, who is son of Dashrath, and there's Ravan and everything. But throughout it all, when Ram goes to the forest, in the Jain Ramayana, he keeps meeting Jain sages. And these Jain sages keep giving him Sadupdesh. And then finally, at the end of the Ramayana, when Sita enters into the earth, then Ram becomes enlightened and becomes a Jain. what Jains did was that because the Ramayana was such an influential book, it was going to influence people's minds, and you can't just purge it from their minds. So they did this. So they reinterpreted. They gave a fictionalized retelling of the Ramayana, which was suited for the Jain worldview. Similarly, there are some Bengali Brahmins who became Christians, and they wrote a book called the Christopanishad. And they have in that Christopanishad sages from ancient times apparently having conversation about the glory of Jesus. Now, there is no traditional Acharya mentioned Christopanishad. So this tendency is there in almost all religions to try to reinterpret reality so that it is in harmony with their worldview. So now, you could put it two ways, that say for example, now Buddhism uses this word. Buddhism has the concept of Nirvana, and the Bhagavad-Gita also has the concept of Nirvana. Brahma Nirvanam Gacchati. So now there are many scholars who use this to say that actually the Bhagavad-Gita is also giving a Buddhist message. Or the Bhagavad-Gita drew teachings, certain teachings from Buddha and Buddhism. But if you consider from a historical perspective, there are three possibilities. In fact, one of our spiritual leaders is a he's a quite a good scholar in Indology, and he was at an Indology conference, and he presented this question, and no Indology scholar had an answer to that. He said that, okay, this concept term of Nirvana is there in Buddhism and is there in the Bhagavad Gita. So there are three possibilities. One is that the Bhagavad Gita presents that term first and Buddhism took it. Second is Buddhism had the term and Bhagavad Gita took it. And third is both of them evolved in parallel. Both of them used it in parallel. So how do you know which is right? So nobody has evidence to prove that Buddhism actually preceded the Bhagavad Gita. Now we, from the traditional perspective, we say the Bhagavad Gita is 5000 years old. Buddha's date is not very precisely known, but broadly it's around 2500 years old. Now even if the mainstream scholars don't accept that Krishna is 5000 years old, but still there is no decisive evidence to say that Krishna came after Buddha or the Bhagavad Gita came after the Buddhism. But certain narratives are told and they become mainstream sometimes. So we have to look at the basis of those narratives. Now with respect to this, did Buddhism have the term Dhamma first? Well, the Mimamsa Shastras, the Vedanta Sutra starts with Athato Brahma Jikyasa. So the Mimamsa Sutra begins with Athato Dharma Jikyasa. The primary question is, what is Dharma? So each of Mimamsa is basically one school of thought. There are six systems of philosophy which traditionally evolved within the Indian tradition, and these six systems were basically all claim to have been emerged from the Vedas. So the Vedas are books, and now which philosophy do these books teach? So different sages interpreted the Vedas in different ways, and then we have Vaisheshika, Nyaya, Mimamsa, Vedanta, like that different systems came up. So now it's at one level it's very clear that the Vedic culture preceded Buddhism. There's no doubt about that, because in this valley civilization so many things are there. I don't think any scholar will doubt that, because Buddha, he did rail against many Vedic practices. In fact, he did say that the Vedic animal sacrifices the animal killing in the name of Veda should not be done. So definitely the Vedas preceded Buddha. There's no doubt about that. Now if you consider the term Buddha, now the Mimamsa was an interpretation of the Vedas. So there are basically six systems of orthodox philosophy. They call it Astik and Nastik. So six Astik philosophies came out, which accepted the authority of the Vedas, but gave an interpretation of the Vedas. And the three which are Nastik. Nastik doesn't necessarily mean atheistic. Nastik there means not accepting the authority of the Vedas. So there's Buddhism, Jainism, and it's a Charvakism. Charvakism was just materialism entirely. So the Mimamsa Sutra is definitely much before because it's one of the traditional interpretations of the Vedas, and in it the concept of Dharma is definitely central. So I would say that we can make a reasonable case that the concept of Dharma was there in Hinduism. It's in the, you can say the word Hinduism is modern, but you can say that whatever the tradition is derived from the Vedic literature, it was there. So it's quite a questionable idea to say that from Buddhism this came over here. Now as far as Buddha being the incarnation of Vishnu, there are certain things which are accepted based on certain authorities. And those who do not accept that authority, you cannot expect them to accept those things. So we have to choose our battles. Say for example, if you want to say that God exists to somebody who is a scientist, and if you say that Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada says God exists, therefore God exists. Yeah, I don't care for Bhaktivedanta Swami. But you say Einstein, Newton, Galileo, these big scientists, they all believed in God. Oh, really? So then that person will think about it. Kelvin, Pascal, all of them believed in God. So we have to find out the right source of authority based on which the discussion takes place. So the idea that Buddha is an incarnation of Vishnu is not something which Buddhists are likely to accept. So we don't even have to go in that direction, especially that if we are dealing with Buddhists. We focus on, there are many commonalities between Buddhism and Vaishnavism. There is a devotee scholar, Stephen Rosen, Satyaraj Prabhu. He has written a book called From Nothingness to Personhood. And in that book, he quite elaborately explains both the similarities of Buddhism and Vaishnavism, and also about how the same principles are enunciated in a deeper and clearer way in the Vaishnava tradition. So we could talk about that. See, there are certain debatable issues whose resolution will depend primarily on authority. And somebody doesn't, is not likely to accept that authority, then don't get into that debate. Okay? Thank you. Yes?
So, see, my question is that we say that Buddha is an incarnation of Lord Krishna. So, if you find me having his own talent in the actual because there are innumerable talents from which his incarnation resides over there, and Buddha is worshipped as a slave one. So, this also gets the impression which Krishna is that we also get to ask under the Guru in our.
Yeah, good question. Okay, good question. So, when Buddha is also an incarnation of the Lord, and does he also have his planet in the spiritual world? And will those who follow him go there? See, there is the principle that God comes at different times and teaches different things for different levels of people. So, even Krishna, if you consider in the Govardhan Leela, just before that, before Indra showers his rains, Krishna speaks the Karma Mimamsa philosophy to provoke Indra. And Krishna says, actually, you don't have to worship any god. You don't think that Indra is giving us rains. If we do our punya, if we do our duty, then Indra is duty bound to give rains. We don't have to please, do anything separate to please him. And there, Krishna is talking about his philosophy that you just work and all the results will come. You don't have to worship any worship separate from work. Now that is not the teaching of Vedantic literature. And when Krishna is speaking this, in that context, he is speaking it primarily to provoke Indra. He is not there speaking as a acharya giving the timeless siddhanta. So that means even Krishna's own words may not be accepted as conclusively authoritative if they are not according to Siddhanta. So that context is extremely important. Without that we just can't get a proper understanding of things. So similarly, Buddha came for a particular mission. So you could say that broadly Buddha's mission was to raise people to a level of pre-theistic goodness. There is a basic pre-theistic morality. Buddha is not non-theistic, but he's not explicitly theistic also. Because there was a lot of ritualism at that time. And Buddha said that stop worrying about these rituals. Just live an ethically, moral, ethically proper life. But he said, no, we are told in the scripture to do the rituals. Now he decided at that time that he didn't want to get into debate about what that scripture teaches. Because he was not born in a Brahmin family where he, and that's not because, that could be one reason because. We don't know why the Lord does a particular thing. But he chose not to take on the Brahminical authorities at his time. This is what you think the Vedas are, I'm not going to get involved in that. But I will give people principles which can help elevate them to a higher level of consciousness. So certainly if somebody follows Buddha's teachings, they will be elevated. Of course, they have to follow it properly. and Buddha was strongly against animal killing for flesh, for meat eating. But many Buddhists unfortunately eat meat now. So you have to see how well they are following. But overall, if one follows, one will get elevated. Now, will they get liberated? For that, they have to actually develop love for God. So now, what about love for Buddha, if they develop? See, there is, on I have a website, The Spiritual Scientist, where I have a series of talks on world religions. So in that, I have described the history of Buddhism quite elaborately. There is a personalist tradition that developed within Buddhism also in the 11th, 12th century, several centuries after Buddha departed. And that tradition does talk about Buddha as a worshipable Lord. Although Buddha himself doesn't have not talked about it like that. Buddha is talking about, I am enlightened, that I am enlightened, and if you follow the path that I am giving you, you will also become enlightened. So it is more of enlightenment rather than worship. So people who follow Buddha will definitely get elevated. To enter the kingdom of God, one needs to have a personal relationship of love with God. So if that relationship is developed, then they will attain God. Okay?
Thank you.
Yeah. Other questions? Welcome to yesterday. See, it's very difficult to predict anyone's personal specific destination, because you could say that people have, see, there is a particular philosophy and there is a particular philosophical worldview. But not everyone who affiliates with a particular path assimilate that philosophical worldview. People come to a spiritual path because of many different reasons. Nowadays, Buddhism is the fastest growing religion in the West. And most people who follow Buddhism, they follow some kind of Zen Buddhism or something like that. They are mostly for mindfulness. Just calm your mind down, be peaceful. They're not having any spiritual conceptions at all. So, just because a particular religion has a particular worldview doesn't necessarily mean that all the practitioners of that religion will have that worldview. Because every practitioner is an individual. And each person comes to religion for various reasons. So now, as far as religions are concerned, the way religions are portrayed in the media, Buddhism is probably the religion which gets the maximum good press. Now there are movies like Little Buddha, Saint Buddha and things like that. And there are many Hollywood stars who say openly they adopt Buddhist principles. Very few Hollywood stars will say that we adopt Muslim or Christian, or I don't think there are any Indians in Hollywood that big who profess to follow Hindu principles. But so people may come to that particular path because it's a glamour, it's a cool path. So whether they have assimilated that worldview, whether they have developed that kind of consciousness, that will depend on each individual. So if somebody has developed an impersonalist conception where there is one infinite stream of consciousness and we want to unite, merge into that stream of consciousness, if they develop that, then that's what they will get. So in some ways, Buddha Shunya and Shankara's Brahma, they are intellectual clones. The nomenclature is different, but you know cloning? So intellectual clones means conceptually they're very similar. So Shankaracharya, when he talked about Brahma, the way he analyzed and presented Brahma within Advaita Vedanta, that is very similar to the way Buddha and Buddha's followers have presented Shunya. So if somebody has developed that kind of conception by following Buddhism, then they may go towards that impersonal destination. Okay. Yes.
As we all animals are in some way or other the parts of Krishna, so serving them will not please Krishna.
So how do you serve animals? By adopting them as pets?
Humanity.
No, but how are you talking about serving animals?
Means serving human beings basically, other human beings with love, care, humanity. Something like those who are in need, serving their needs.
Okay, yes. So you're not talking about animals, you're talking about human beings or both or what?
Both.
Okay, let's focus on human beings first. You can talk. So as all living beings are parts of God, so if we serve people, aren't we serving God also? Just wipe this. See, this is a theme which is, it seems very, very appealing as well as sensible. So if you consider two circles. So this is, you could say, Manav Seva. And this is Madhav Seva. So there could be certain services which we do to human beings which can fall in this area. There's a social welfare organization. Its motto is God in double quotes. God sends disasters, we send relief. So they are explicitly atheistic. So now they are serving human beings, but actually they are anti-theistic. So such service to human beings, that service to God, well, it's not really taking people towards God. And if people take that service and they also tell their ideology, it may take people away from God. Or similarly, like I told, if you give a drunkard money, they may just use it to drink more. Although we may think this drunkard is also part of God and I'm giving him for that purpose. So you will have to see, the Mahabharata says that the rightness and the wrongness of actions can be decided in three broad ways: intent, content and consequence. Why am I doing, what am I doing, and what is the result of doing it? So now if you consider this, the first example I give, that God sends disasters, we send relief. There the intent itself is to malign God and to take people away from God. Then the consequence, if we give an alcoholic money, the consequence is that it makes their life worse. So although in content you could say that helping people who are in need is good, but the merit of things is not determined only by the content. You also have to look at the intent and the consequence. So is service to man service to God? Yes, definitely. If that service helps man to come closer to God. So this will mean that the people who are doing the service, their intention is that they're seeing God in them and they want to go closer to God and they want to take others closer to God. And they do that service in an atmosphere, in a setting, which also helps people to come closer to God. That is good. But if it is otherwise, then that's not so good. So, we as a movement, we focus, sometimes people say why this kind of idea comes up is that there's these two movies, OMG and PK. You heard of those movies? So they were satires on religion and many of them had some good points to make, many valid criticisms of religion, but they also had generalizations, very blanket generalizations. So I wrote two books responding to the questions raised in those movies. So it was OMG re-answering the questions, and then there was GK for PK. So GK was general knowledge, God knowledge and Gita knowledge. So based on all those, I had answered the questions you raised. So sometimes people may say that, oh, you spend so much money on worshipping God in the temple and people are starving and you don't give anything to them. And that way, people say, why waste so much money on God? Just give money to the poor. Well, that sounds reasonable, but why are you comparing giving money to poor people with worshipping God in the temple? Why not compare giving money to poor people with watching a cricket match? You know, the amount of money that is spent on IPL, you know, that money is enough to feed all the hungry people of India throughout the year. So when you put two things in comparison, there is always some agenda over there. And when you put a religious ritual which is particularly expensive and put it in contrast with poor people, the agenda over there is emotionally manipulating people against religion. So if we think of religion only as doing some kind of worship, then we say, okay, what is the use of this? But if you see overall religion, when somebody worships God directly, chants the holy names, worships the God, worships the images of God in the temple, the deities, and lives a God-centered life, that brings out their virtues. In general, people who are more possessive will become more charitable if they become more spiritual and devoted. And you see, traditionally, also many temples would have annakshetras around them, where if you're in that temple area, the Udupi temple and so many temples, you just get, anybody who goes there gets free food. We in our movement also have Food for Life, which is the world's biggest vegetarian food relief program. And in India also, the midday meal, lakhs and lakhs of children are given free food. But it is prasad. It's food that is offered to the Lord. So the idea over there is that if something is only in this area, or something is only in this area, if it is in this area, it is not spiritual. And sometimes, and you have to see the intent and the consequence, whether it's actually doing good or doing bad. Something which is in this area is the best. Now, something which is in this area, we have to see how it is being done and for what purpose it is being done. In general, in society, not everybody is going to be an activist. Even in general society, even people, good people, not everybody is on a war to end poverty. Nobody wants poverty, but not everybody is an activist for that. So bhakti is an entire culture. It is not just worship of God. It is bhakti that has inspired so much poetry. It has inspired so much literature. It has inspired so much art. In the past, almost all of Indian art, culture, music, it was all spiritual. It was that which inspired people to do that. So even in the Western world, if you see, all the greatest artists, Michelangelo and Leonardo da Vinci and all of them, they were religiously minded people and they did religious art. So it was religion that promoted the arts. It was religion that promoted culture. So Madhav Seva is a complete culture. And within that culture, humanitarian service is also a part of that culture. So if somebody is a devotee, actually they can do better humanitarian service than somebody who is not a devotee. And that way, is Krishna pleased if we serve his parts? Definitely. He's definitely pleased. But that should be our intention. It's not just to care for this person, but also to connect this person with Krishna. So if we care for people's bodies and minds in a context where we are also caring for their souls, then that is holistic care. Otherwise, the care may be, even if it is well-intentioned, sometimes the consequences can be counterproductive. Like I talked about social engineering, sometimes backfiring. So we try to integrate social service within the context of devotional service.
I
have a choice to go on an NSS camp and NSS camp. And an NSS camp, this camp. Okay.
So which should I choose?
If you have a choice to go between an NSS camp and an NSS camp, what should you choose? I think when you come to specific choices, it becomes a little difficult to give generic answers. See, I'll give broad principle over here. Generally, the material and the spiritual are not meant to be in competition with each other. The material has its place and the spiritual has its place. Now within material also there are multiple levels of material. Now you could say material could be, oh, I just want to go on a sightseeing tour somewhere, or I want to go to a party, there will be booze and all kinds of things, or I want to go for a camp. So broadly you could say in material also there is sattva, rajas, tamas. So generally positioning the material as a and the spiritual as alternative competitors, that's not a healthy way of looking at things. The spiritual has its place, the material has its place. And certainly within the material, we could say something which is sattvic, sattva guna, is much better than something in rajas or tamas. If somebody wants to go on a party where people are just going to smoke and drink, or somebody wants to go on a camp where they're going to learn some discipline, do some kind of constructive activities, that's much better. The second one is much better. So, going specifically further, now, ideally, don't put the two in competition. Both have their own place. But if suppose in a particular situation we have to choose, then we have to see what exactly is it that inspires or equips us most, the best, to make a contribution in life. There are different people who say for example, now I was in Ohio State University in Columbus, and there a girl came and met me. So she is doing her PhD in some field where she has to do animal testing. Quite a complicated animal testing she has to do. So she was saying that initially my thought was that I don't want to do this. But if I don't do this, then I cannot grow in this career. But she said there is an option. Nowadays, Silicon Valley is trying to make everything artificial. So because veganism is quite popular, so now what they are trying to do is they are trying to make artificial meat. That means the whatever is, it's synthetically, chemically produced, it don't kill animals, but what you get is chemically similar to meat and it tastes also similar to meat. Now how successful that will be and how much it will replace mainstream meat, that's all open, these are open-ended questions. But certainly there will not be killing or slaughter of animals, won't be there. So if somebody can't give up meat, that would be much better than that. So what she was telling me is that if she can go deep into this field, and if she goes, then she can have animal testing done on biologically made animals, or like laboratorily made simulants which are not living animals, but they behave similarly. So, but if she is to do this, then she has to go deep into that research. She may do a lot of animal testing, even much more than what normal course would require. Because then she has to replicate it. This kind of, that this produces this kind of results, and this produces this kind of results. So, and I was talking with her, I saw that she had a lot of passion for doing that. So, if somebody has a deep-rooted passion for working in a particular field, and then by working in that field, they can bring about a change in consciousness. Now, if animal testing, the kind of brutality that happens to animals in animal testing, some of it is horrendous. So if somebody can do that kind of work, then there is no need for them to simply say, oh, this is material, I will not do it. So that could be somebody has a very deep-rooted passion for it. Could we have some second situation where somebody has no passion, but just their profession. I just want to do it. I chose as a career before I came to spiritual life also. But now for my career, I have to do this. Now somebody might decide that, okay, you know, it's just 1 or 2 years, I'll do it. And in the future, within that whole industry also, I'll choose a job where I don't have anything to do. I don't have to do animal testing directly. That's also okay. But somebody who has a particular career chart in which they have an option, whether they can go through the animal testing route, or they can go without it. Now, if they go through that, they might develop their career in one way, they can develop in another way. In the third case, they have no particular preferences and they have alternative choice of professions. Then why go into animal testing? Best to avoid it. So you could say there are multiple options based on how strongly somebody is invested in something. So for somebody, if NSS is just okay, we have vacations and just outing, we have to go somewhere, and many of my friends are going there. It's more a social occasion along with some good values. Then that means there's no particular passion over there. Then if it's in the second or the third category, then we try to get that same social circle in a spiritual association. Come for a spiritual camp, because comparatively speaking, the number of people who are today sharing pure spiritual wisdom are far lesser than the number of people who have patriotic sentiments and want to do some work for national activism. Many times when I give college talks in college, one time I was giving a talk, and after that a professor said, you know, I was from COEP, he says, you know, you wasted a COEP engineering seat. So you said, India lost an engineer because of you. So I told him, India didn't lose an engineer, America lost an engineer. So if I had not, I had already given GRE, I had already got a very good score in GRE. So probably I would have been in America. My maternal uncle had his own company in America, and he did not have any sons. So he wanted me to go there and inherit his company. So of course I frustrated him, unfortunately, unfortunately for him. But anyway, so it's not that simple, that this choice and that choice. So if somebody doesn't have a particular passion for a particular field, so at that time I thought that I can write software engineer, I can be a software engineer, I can become a work, and I can contribute to society that way, even with spiritual knowledge. But the number of people who are software engineers are large, the number of people who are directly teaching spiritual knowledge from a scientific perspective are not that many. So we have to see how effectively we can contribute. So if somebody is very deeply invested in NSS, then for such a person, if they have to choose between the two, it may be a very difficult choice. They may want to go there, but then if they learn some spiritual values, then they can bring those spiritual values with them even in their national activist kind of work also. So rather than making it necessarily a choice between this and that, we see spiritual and material not as competitors, but spiritual as the director of the material. So if somebody has a material passion, by passion I'm not using it in a negative sense, passion means something which somebody is very strongly driven to do, then it's best that they use their passion constructively, and spirituality can help them to do that. But if somebody doesn't have a lot of passion, then there is no need to get oneself more involved if anyway one is not very interested in it. So if it's just a profession for you, or just a social get together, it's just some good activity to do in the vacation, then it's better to do something spiritual. Okay? Yeah? So, are there modifications that happen in religion with respect to time? Let's say Christianity rejected reincarnation, or Buddhism also shifted from Nirvana to Bodhisattva, compassionate work in this world. And Bhakti also seeing not just liberation, but compassion in this world. Okay, change is inevitable just by being in the material world, because the material world is characterized by change. And even religious traditions have to respond to the changing situations in the world. So now every religious tradition has its core, which are like its central principles. and then it has its periphery, which are like the details, the specific applications. So the core should not change, but the periphery, the details, the specific applications, they need to change. If they don't change, then it can become completely irrelevant. It's like, say for example, till the 17th century almost, 17th or middle of the 18th century, there are a lot of polemical means debates between the personalists and impersonalists in Indian history. But then when the British came to India, and now what happened, Muslims were ruling India for a long time, but the Muslim rule was never, Islam was never considered an intellectual competitor to the Vedic Dharma. It is politically they had gained the upper hand, but they never, Indians never considered them as, they had a bigger, better philosophy than us. But when the European colonists came, because they had science and technology with them, so the rational worldview started appealing. And many people started feeling that as compared to the superstitious kind of worship of our tradition, this is rational, is much better. So it was like intellectual competitor. But then unfortunately, many of the traditional Brahmins, they said, we are not going to refute or debate with anyone who doesn't even know Sanskrit. But by that, essentially they ended up becoming irrelevant. And in fact, if you see most of modern Hinduism, like you're calling this camp as Renaissance, there was a Renaissance in India, started in Bengal. So most of the leaders of that Renaissance were people who were at the junction of Western, of European influence and traditional connection. And they reshaped the Indian tradition, the Vedic tradition, to meet the challenges of modernity. So much of modern Hinduism has emerged from there. So now those who did not say that we will only talk in Sanskrit, they just became irrelevant. Right? That's how Buddhism and Jainism actually spread, because many of the Brahmins said, we will not debate with anyone who doesn't speak Sanskrit. But these religions, they spread in Pali and Prakrit, which are the common languages of the people. And they spread in huge numbers. And eventually it happened that once their numbers spread, some of them also learned Sanskrit, and they wrote books in Sanskrit also. But by that time, they had become very big. So there has to be presentation according to time, place, circumstance. Desha kala vibhagavit. Desha kala dharmagyo. The words like that come repeatedly in the Bhagavad Purana also. So modification, if it is a adjustment of the details so that there is relevance and connection with the current situation, then that is desirable. That is definitely desirable. If that kind of adaptation is not there, then that religion will basically become a museum piece. It will be something which you can, this kind of religion existed, like the Mayan civilization was there, the Aztec civilization, so just existing. There's nothing there right now. We have Egyptian pharaohs. But if you go to Egypt, there is nothing like that now. Except, of course, the pyramids and stuff like that. But no living tradition continuing from there. So there has to be adaptation. But the danger is that in adapting, sometimes core principles might also be changed. So in Buddhism, there is something called as Tantric Buddhism. So now Tantra is what? Tantra is itself, there is left-hand Tantra and right-hand Tantra. So basically, Tantra is the idea, see, there is material and spiritual. Tantra is the idea that, so Vedanta says material and spiritual are separate and you have to transcend the material to go to the spiritual. Tantra says you can use the material and spiritual are separate, but you can use the material to attain the spiritual. And say, for example, deity worship. It is the divine who is manifest in a form that is made of matter. But from that, we can meditate and become elevated towards the divine. So this is that part of Tantra which is holistic, which can be uplifting. But another aspect of Tantra is the idea that they say that actually, there's this modern teacher, Osho, who was a modern exponent of Tantra. He says, Sambhog se Samadhi. So the idea was that when a man and a woman unite, actually speaking, through that union, you can have spiritual elevation. Now, generally, when a man and a woman unite, nobody thinks about anything spiritual at that time. Isn't it? The sensual thoughts completely dominate the consciousness. But that was the idea. Now, so there are some in the, I think it was maybe 1,000 or more years after Buddha came, there are some Buddhist teachers, they said Buddha came in our dream, and till then Buddhism was primarily a monastic tradition. The main followers of Buddhists were monks, and those who were householders, they would also live a relatively simpler life. But the main followers are monks. Then this person, there are some teachers, they said Buddha came in our vision and told us that actually we can practice Tantra and grow in Buddhism also. And then in the past, people were not mature enough to understand. That's why Buddha did not give it. But now we are given it. So then that same Buddha who renounced family life to practice spirituality, his followers, several hundred years down the line, started doing the exact opposite. They started using Tantra and they started having a sexual union and claiming that that will lead to spiritual elevation. So this is not just a change in details. This is like a rejection of the core principle itself. So when there is a change in details, that just makes the religion more relevant. But when there is a change in the core principles, then that religion is no longer that religion. It's almost like a caricature of that religion. There was Mark Twain, he said that, Mark Twain is an insightful British American thinker. He said that if Christ came back today, there is one thing he would certainly not be, and that is a Christian. More specifically, he said that if Christ came today, he would not be a member of the church. There are some people who differentiate between Christianity and churchianity. So churchianity, they just go to ritual, go to church, and they say that, what do you do in a church? Three things: pay, pray, and obey. You know, you give some charity, you pray to God, and you obey whatever is told. Well, that can lead to, if one is not philosophical, that can lead to deviation. So modification is unavoidable because the world keeps changing and the religion has to be relevant to the world. So modification is unavoidable. But that modification will become a deviation if the modification is in the core, in the central principles, not the specific applicational details.
Is it also the case that one religious movement comes and it modifies the previous principles of previous religion and the structure for dominating? Means, if we see the case of Iran and the concept of that we have to not move out the cycle of birth and death and have a compassion for the people that they also get attained. And then we see if the movement of Bhakti movement that it is also talking. The same thing in
a
sense of God.
Okay, that's a good question, yeah. So can one movement be affected by the previous movement? That is that obviously. See, we don't live in a vacuum. Say for example, now today we might talk about say I have written a book on reincarnation. I talk about scientific evidence for the existence of soul. But say somebody 500 years ago would not write a book like that. Because science itself was not present over there. Could say science as a particular methodology. In fact, Newton himself did not call himself a scientist. That time the field was called natural philosophy. So then almost in the 18th century, the word science itself became mainstream for the work of the natural philosophers. So in today's world, we may need to present, because science has a lot of influence, so there has to things that be presented scientifically. So you could say the scientific tradition, if you want to use the word for that, scientific tradition is quite influential today. So therefore, a spiritual tradition will have to present its teachings in a scientific way. So the existence of a pre-existing tradition will affect the way another tradition has to present itself. So with respect to, say, compassion, yes. See, every religion has two drives in it. One is world transcending and the other is world transforming. So if you see Krishna in 4, 7, 8 and 9. 4, 7 and 8 are the famous verses. Yada yada hi dharmasya glanir bhavati bharata abhyutthana dharmasya tadatmanam sujamyaham. Paritranaya sadhanam vinashaya dushkritam dharma samsthapanarthaya sambhavami yuge yuge. So dharma samsthapanarthaya. This is world transforming. But 4, 9 is immediately after that comes. Janma karma chame divyam evam yuvetti tatvataha tyaktva deham punarjanma naiti mameti so arjuna. It's world transforming, attaining Krishna as a board. So every religion has both these aspects, world transcending and world transforming. And depending on a particular spiritual teacher's emphasis, depending on the atmosphere at a particular time, either the world transcending aspect might be emphasized, or sometimes the world transforming aspect might be emphasized. So a lot of factors are there in that. So yes, if now is it that the Buddhist idea of compassion affected the bhakti idea? It could be, but although I think we'll have to do a little more research to check about when exactly the Bodhisattva concept came. Because if you see the idea that we want to transform the world is also there in the traditional Upanishad, the Sarve Jana Sukhina Bhavantu. Let all people be happy and work for that. So now if you consider the bhakti tradition in general has not been that political. That means that say many of the bhakti saints, they were in India when the Islamic rule was there. So most of the bhakti saints did not really inspire like a political revolution against the rulers. It's more that you practice your bhakti in spite of the rulers. And they had some miraculous encounters with some of the rulers who were inspired or transformed in some ways. But there are other times. So at a particular time, if you see Chaitanya Mahaprabhu himself, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, when he was there, he did not encourage, he did not instruct his disciples to build temples in Bengal. So at that time, the Islamic ruler over there was quite barbaric. And there were deities in people's homes, but there are no big temples. In Jagannathpur, there's always a big temple, already a big temple of Lord Jagannath, and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu daily go there. Now when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu sent his disciples to Rupanj Sanatana Goswami to Vrindavan, at that time there was a rule of Akbar going on over there. And Akbar was relatively broad-minded. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Rupanj Sanatana also already they had, you could say, experience, you could say political experience, because they were ministers in the rulership of Nawab Hussain Shah. So he, now they had renounced the world, but he sent them over there. And he said, you negotiate whatever is required and you build temples over there. So in the specific act of building temples, whether how it was applied depends on whether it was how suitable it was and how, not how unsuitable it was. So like that, according to situations, specific activities may be emphasized. So yes. Some spiritual in the Vaishnava tradition also there are two kinds of Vaishnavas, Bhajanandis and Goshtanandis. Bhajanandis are those who focus primarily on world transformation. Sorry, world transcendence. Just you do your worship, do your bhajan and transcend the world. Goshtanandis are those who travel and speak and they try to share spirituality so that we can transform the world also. So that will, both aspects are there and different teachers may emphasize different aspects at different times. Okay.
I want to ask you that as we see the bhakti movement in India, which is open to certain centuries, it was based on the theme of love of God. And many leaders emerged at that time, like Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Tulsidas, Mirabai. So, is it what means of a pattern that a person, means, a thing happened at a time and number of people start following it? Or was it a type of transcendental?
Okay. So we see a lot of the bhakti movement had resurgence in the 13th, 14th century onwards. So was it that a particular thing happens when the atmosphere is conducive for it, or is that a transcendental plan? See, the circumstantial and the transcendental can work together. It's not that the two are competitive. So Srila Prabhupada went to the West at a particular time when the West was going through a cultural upheaval, as a counterculture. So, and Krishna arranged for him to go at that time. If Krishna Prabhupada had gone in 1940s, we don't know what would have happened. But certainly the culture was much more receptive in 1960s than it was in 1940s or 1930s. So, there is a historical aspect to things, and it's good to analyze things historically to get some perspective. See, broadly, religion can be studied in four different ways. And you can call it a scientific, historical, sociological, and psychological. So, sociological means, oh, this was the kind of society at that time, this is why people used to believe these things, and that's how they took up this religion. Psychological is, oh, you know, people have this kind of need, this is an emotional issue, and then they adopted this. So, sociological also involves cultural, whereas psychological involves more of inner things. And historical could be, okay, this ruler was ruling at this time, and this ruler came at that time, and during this time there's a receptivity for this. And you could, scientific means, it's not exactly scientific, you could say philosophical, metaphysical, intellectual basically. And you know, there are people who want answers to questions of life. And at this particular point, this tradition was providing answers to questions. These are the kind of questions people had, and then they provided these answers. So now all of these are approaches to the heart of religion. None of these they actually exhaust religion. So beyond the historical, the psychological, the intellectual, the philosophical, and the historical, or psychological, whatever, beyond all of these is the transcendental. So there is something which people experience within. Generally, the academic study of religion, it focuses on one of these things. See, okay, Gaudiya Vaishnava is a sociological movement, see it as a historical movement, see it as a psychological. It's okay to study it in this way, but there is more to it than that. So God is something, someone who is to be experienced. If we just try to deconstruct religion based on these factors only, then what we will have, we'll have a case of like operation successful, patient dead. You can somebody can have a complete historical account of, and there are people like that. There are in the Western world, there are people who are brilliant professors on Bible, and they know every single detail about the Bible. They know so much about the life of Jesus, and they don't believe in God. They don't believe even in the historicity of Jesus, whether he existed or not. So then, what is the use of that knowledge? So there is, ultimately there is so operation successful means you know all the details, but patient dead means your heart is not spiritually uplifted. So that's why there is a difference between knowledge about God and knowledge of God. It's like, say if there is a small child who is sick. Now the child is taken to a doctor, and the doctor may get various tests done, and the doctor may know the WBC count, the RBC count, the platelets count, this count, that count. Now, the mother does not know any of these things. But who knows the child well? The mother, isn't it? So the doctor is approaching the child more like a biological machine. And what are the readings of the biological machine's functionality? That's what he's finding out. So he may know about the child, but the mother knows the child because there's a personal relationship with the child. So similarly, whenever people approach religion through a historical, psychological, sociological, or philosophical, intellectual way, it's good, but they can know about God. Ultimately, it's a matter of purification and of experience. So that's why when we understand religion from those who have experienced God, or who are at least trying to experience God, then that understanding is very different, much deeper than the understanding we might get from others who are not so personally invested in that path. Okay. Thank you very much. So let's see, how many questions are remaining till now? One, not now, we're not going to discuss now, definitely not, but how many questions are there as such? Are there any cheats too? Where are they? Okay, then maybe we'll have a session, one session in the afternoon. We'll decide what time it will be. But thank you very much for your thoughtful questions, and thank you for tolerating the long answers. Shri Prabhupada.